Hey. Bye, kids. Have fun. Okay. This morning platform is on humanity from origins to extinction, and it is with our own leader, Anne Klaeysen. Okay, for those who don't know Anne yet, here's a little bio. Anne Klaeysen is a leader of the New York Society for Ethical Culture. She holds a doctorate and ministry degree in pastoral counseling from Hebrew Union College, as well as master's degrees in German from the State University of New York at Albany, and business administration from NYU. Dr. Klaeysen is the ethical humanist religious life advisor at Columbia University and the humanist chaplain at NYU. She also participates in several interfaith social justice coalitions and actually does so much, I don't know where she finds time in her day because I cannot keep up with her. And?
Good morning. I'm gonna turn the light on up here. There we go, great. Okay. So I like to use poetry in my platforms, and a while back some folks asked if I would make copies available. So if you'd like to read along, you may. And this first poem is by Faith Sheeran. It's called Early Hominids Slept in Trees. This was before they slipped into caves and painted the drama of the hunt, before their stone tools and splendid fires, when early hominids filled the trees like night. They climbed a ladder of branches into evening, where they arranged themselves beneath the applause of leaves. There were windstorms and lightning, and somehow babies were held and people snored or turned over. Surely someone was afraid of heights, and someone must have secured a place at the bottom or slept on the ground, demonstrating how it might be done. Balanced up there in the mythic beginning, they were safer from predators that walked on four legs, swishing tails. They clung to the trunk, felt the world growing colder, the new power in their thumbs. Trees were like houses, and going home meant climbing into the sky, where words appeared inside them like stars. Last summer, I traveled to Washington, D.C. to teach a seminar at the American Humanist Association Center for Education, that's formerly the Humanist Institute. It was an introductory class and a prerequisite for other classes that humanists and people interested in humanism would like to take. For the first time, we added a field trip to the seminar. And we took a trip to the Smithsonian's Hall of Human Origins to help us understand a question. What does it mean to be human? After all, that is the grand narrative of humanism. The exhibition with interactive displays is based on decades of cutting-edge research by Smithsonian scientists and is the result of an international collaboration with over 60 research and educational organizations and over 100 researchers from around the world. It was fantastic. What I particularly liked were the interactive aspects of it. And it was so wonderful to see families there, families with young children, because the displays were there for all ages, and so you could choose the display that was just right for your age. And it was so interesting to watch the adults and the children interacting in these different displays. My daughter was there with me as well. She works for the AHA and the center. And I asked her to take a photograph of me standing next to a female Homo erectus. She was much taller than I. And her species existed much longer than Homo sapiens are likely to exist. It was so interesting to see these reproductions set up at the different heights, and then to imagine the stories that they lived and the stories that they might tell us. One of the books that I bought in the bookstore afterwards, you may have heard of it. It's by Yuval Noah Harari. He's an Israeli. And he wrote a book called Sapiens, A Brief History of Humankind. What I like about his book is that he does what not enough scientists do, and that is write a book for the layperson. Because we, as humanists, need to understand science, all branches of science. It's important that we do. But unfortunately, and I'll speak only for myself, I don't understand a lot of the mathematics and the chemistry and the biology. So I rely upon writers who can explain it to me in a way that I can understand, who can give me both the data and the charts and the equations, but can also tell me a story. And so while I understand that there may be some criticism of what he wrote, and that's fine, I find it very well researched and documented. And so I'm going to tell you some of what he writes in his story. And this is it. There were humans long before there was history. Animals much like us, modern humans, appeared on this planet, the Earth, about 2.5 million years ago. And for countless generations, they did not stand out from the myriad other organisms. In fact, the most important thing to know about prehistoric humans is that they were insignificant animals, with no more impact on their environment than gorillas, fireflies, or jellyfish. Another important thing to understand, and it is a common fallacy, even among those Homo sapiens who grudgingly acknowledged that they were evolved. The common fallacy is to envision that these different human species were arranged along a straight line of descent or ascent. This linear model gives the mistaken impression that at any particular moment, only one type of human inhabited the Earth, and that all earlier species were merely older models of us. The truth is that from about 2 million years ago until about around 2,000 years ago, the world was home at one and the same time to several human species. The Earth of 100 millennia ago was walked by at least 6 different species of humans. It's our current exclusivity, not that multi-species past, that's peculiar and, as Harari says, perhaps incriminating. There is something about us that we think we are special and we are exclusive. And that narrative permeates through a lot of our mythology, a lot of our storytelling, and in a lot of our nation states, right? United States, we're number one. No, we're not. We're not the number one species, although we have the greatest impact. Here are some conclusions that Harari makes in no particular order. We rule the world because we are the only animal that can believe in things that exist purely in our imagination, such as gods, states, money, and human rights. Sapiens are ecological serial killers. Even with Stone Age tools, our ancestors wiped out half the planet's large terrestrial mammals well before the advent of agriculture. Money is the most universal and pluralistic system of mutual trust ever devised. It seems that money is the only thing everyone trusts. Capitalism is a religion rather than just an economic theory, and it's the most successful religion to date. The treatment of animals in modern agriculture may turn out to be the worst crime in history. We are far more powerful than our ancestors, but we aren't much happier. Those are some of his conclusions. And now for another poem, because we did evolve. Evolution by Eliza Griswold. Was it dissatisfaction or hope that beckoned some of the monkeys down from the trees and on to the damp, forbidden musk of the forest floor? Which one tested his thumbs against the twig and awkwardly dug a grub from the soil? What did the tribe above think as it leaned on the slender branches, watching the others, frustrated, embarrassed, but pinching grubs with leathery fingers into their mouths? The moral is movement is awkward. The lesson is fumble. But you know, we almost didn't make it. We almost vanished from the face of the earth. Robert Krulik wrote something called When Human Beings Almost Vanished from the Earth 70,000 years ago. And he refers to the science writer Sam Keen, who said, he put it bluntly, we damn near went extinct. Once in our history, the worldwide population of human beings skidded so sharply, we were down to roughly 1,000 reproductive adults. One study suggests it may have been as few as 40. More likely, there was definitely a drastic dip, maybe between 5 and 10,000, and they struggled in these pitiful little clumps. And the reason for this is because there was a volcano named Toba on Sumatra, an Indonesian island, and around 70,000 BC, it went off, blowing roughly 650 miles of vaporized rock into the air. It's the largest volcanic eruption we know of, dwarfing everything else. Just find where I am here. Okay. I lost my place. Bear with me. Here we go. Okay. So that's what it did. And we had a few people who were then struggling to get back together. Now, here we go. It was that ash, excuse me, the dust and the vapor probably dimmed the sun for 6 years, disrupted the seasonal rains, choked off streams, and scattered over whole cubic miles of hot ash. Imagine wading through a giant ashtray. It spread across acres and acres. Not only that, there's some conjecture based on some arguable evidence that the earth got colder. The world was already having an ice age, and this, they think, with the dust made the sunlight bounce off. So the sunshine was bouncing back into space. Again, according to Sam Keen, there's in fact evidence that the average temperature dropped 20 plus degrees in some spots, after which the great grassy plains of Africa may have shrunk way back, keeping the small bands of humans small and hungry for hundreds, if not thousands, more years. It took almost 200,000 years after that to reach our first billion, and that was in 1804. By now, we are now the most fantastic growth spurt, about 3 billion in 1960, another billion almost every 13 years. And then around October 2011-12, we zipped right past 6 billion. So we've gone through a lot since then, Homo sapiens have, from almost vanishing to 6 billion of us. We've gone through different ages and different revolutions, a cognitive revolution, agriculture, industrial, technological. We've been through a lot. And now the age that some scientists suggest that we're in is called the Anthropomorphic Age. And what that means is that it's applying increasingly by a number of scientists to this period on Earth and human history in which our species is influencing a host of planetary systems in big ways with long-lasting consequences. So here we go, 70,000 years ago, a few thousand of us struggling along, 2011-12, we got 7 billion of us, and we are making such an incredible impact upon the Earth that we're actually calling it a geological age, right? It means that this is a time that is the end of the Holocene Age, the epoch that lasted past the Ice Age, kind of in a looser term, and now the Anthropomorphic Age, an emerging name, which is kind of a lack of a better name for it, a time in which the global environment is increasingly what we choose it to be, for better or for worse. So Andrew C. Revkin, who wrote an article and referred to Sam Keen, first addressed this in 1992. It was a book that he wrote on global climate change, forecasting the future, and he called it the Anthropocene at that time. So now we're calling it the Anthropocene. He said his Greek wasn't very good at that time. This is back in 92. But what he said back then is very relevant still today. He said, perhaps Earth scientists of the future, written in 92, will name this post-Holocene era for its causative element, for us. We are entering an age that might someday be referred to as the Anthropocene. After all, it is a geological age of our own making. The challenge now is to find a way to act that will make geologists of the future look upon this age as a remarkable time, a time in which a species began to take into account the long-term impact of its actions. The alternative may be to leave a legacy of irresponsibility and neglect of the biosphere that could eventually manifest itself in the fossil record as just one more mass extinction, like the record of bones and footprints left behind by the dinosaurs. And so in December, the philosopher Todd May, and I've used some of his essays in some of the workshops that I've done here, he's not only a philosopher at Clemson University, he's one of the philosophical advisors for the television show The Good Place. Does anybody watch The Good Place? Hey, Fabio. They actually do use philosophers to advise them on this show. And it is about ethics. I highly recommend it. We could do a whole program here just on The Good Place. At any rate, Todd May asked the question, would human extinction be a tragedy? He wants to suggest, at least tentatively, both that it would be a tragedy and that it might just be a good thing. He writes, human beings are destroying large parts of the inhabitable Earth and causing unimaginable suffering to many of the animals that inhabit it. And he says this is through three different ways. First, human contribution to climate change is devastating ecosystems. Second, increasing human population is encroaching on ecosystems that would otherwise be intact. And third, factory farming, I know your daughter has done a lot on factory farming. Factory farming fosters the creation of millions upon millions of animals for whom it offers nothing but suffering and misery before slaughtering them in often barbaric ways. Todd says there is no reason to think that those practices are going to diminish anytime soon. Quite the opposite. Humanity, then, is the source of devastation of the lives of conscious animals on a scale that is difficult to comprehend. So he asks that question. He says, you know, after all, you know, music, art, poetry, you know, haven't we done something good? Of course, we humans are the only ones who can appreciate that. So there's that, right? It's all from our perspective. It's all from our perspective. Todd asks, so then, how much suffering and death of non-human life would we be willing to countenance to save Shakespeare, our sciences, and so forth? Unless we believe there is such a profound moral gap between the status of human and non-human animals, whatever responsible answer we come up with will be surpassed by the harm and suffering we inflict upon animals. That's quite a weighty thought to take into mind. That moral gap, right, between humans and non-humans. One thing that he says is that at least more and more humans are becoming aware of their environment. They're becoming aware that we are just animals, animals that at one time were insignificant among all the other organisms on this earth. We are now significant, but in what ways? And are we going to take responsibility for that significance, for that impact? He concludes, our own science is revealing that richness of the biosphere to us, ironically giving us reason to eliminate along with our own continued existence. We have to think about that, don't we? Right? It is, in effect, suicide too. Not just non-human animals, but what are we doing to ourselves because we are in such serious denial of that impact? Well, you may have heard that the United Nations came out with a report on the climate, and they say we have 12 years to limit climate change catastrophe. And this is what they say. The world's leading climate scientists have warned there is only a dozen years for global warming to be kept to a maximum of 1.5 degrees centigrade, beyond which even a degree will significantly worsen the risks of drought, floods, extreme heat, and poverty for hundreds of millions of people. We're doing this to ourselves, to ourselves. The author of this landmark report by the United Nations Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change says that it is time, it is a line in the sand, and what it says to our species is that this is the moment and we must act now. Deborah Roberts is one of the co-chairs. She said, this is the largest clarion bell from the science community, and I hope it mobilizes people and dents the mood of complacency. Complacency. Well, thank goodness for the young people who were here on Thursday, the 21 plaintiffs. Each one of them told their personal stories, where they're growing up, the impact that they have experienced, and the impact they anticipate they will continue to experience as they grow older. Sea level rise would affect 10 million more people by 2100, if the half degree extra warming brought a forecast of 10 centimeters additional pressure on the coastlines. The greatest difference would be to nature. Insects, which are vital for the pollination of crops and plants, are almost twice as likely to lose half their habitat at 2 degrees centigrade compared to 1.5 degrees centigrade. I could go on and on, but I do recommend that you take a look at it. Go to the United Nations and the report. It is in great detail, well researched, well documented. And what they say at the end of the report is, we have presented governments with pretty hard choices. We have pointed out the enormous benefits of keeping to 1.5 degrees centigrade, and also the unprecedented shift in energy systems and transport that would be needed to achieve that. The other co-chair, Jim Skea of the working group, says, we show it can be done within the laws of physics and chemistry. Then the final tick box is political will. We cannot answer that. Only our audience can, and that is the government that receives our report. Well, this year, in September 2019, the Secretary General, Antonio Guterres, will convene a climate summit to bring together the world leaders of governments, the private sector, the civil society together on a multilateral process to increase and accelerate climate action and ambition. And this summit will focus on the key sector where action can make the most difference. I don't think I need to tell you this, but I will anyway, and that is heavy industry, nature-based solutions, cities, energy, resilience, and climate finance. We can do it. We need to do it. Our young people are doing it. You know who else is doing it? Who else is really coming forward? African-American women. Essence had an article recently. Black women are leading the way in environmental justice. Why? Because it impacts people of color more than anyone else. Black women nationwide are boldly leading a growing effort to heighten public awareness of how environmental issues like pollution and climate change affect African Americans and other people of color, and galvanizing the push for environmental justice in their communities. The U.S. Environmental Protection Agency defines environmental justice as the fair treatment and meaningful involvement of all people, regardless of race, color, national origin, or income, with respect to the development, implementation, and enforcement of environmental laws, regulations, and policies. Just like in the civil rights movements of the 1950s and 60s, this environmental justice movement began at a grassroots level. And it began in 1982 with a small group of black men and women protesting the construction of a hazardous waste center in their county of North Carolina, in their community. It's now widely regarded as the catalyst of environmental justice movement. They got the word back in 1982 and took to the streets, their community, and they made a difference in their community because they connected the dots long before many other people did. The environmental justice movement has always been led and powered by black women. In 1988, Peggy Shepherd co-founded We Act for Environmental Justice. That's an organization that helps New Yorkers, especially those in low-income communities of color, fight environmental policies that have a negative impact on them. As Shepherd said, in northern Manhattan, residents continue to suffer disproportionately from the impacts of air pollution, particularly those living in East Harlem. Steve Serling, one of our members, teaches at Park East, a high school in East Harlem, and he brought, oh my gosh, at least a dozen of his students on Thursday. And they got to meet the 21 plaintiffs in this environmental case. They're learning what it's all about, and they're learning how they can help in their community. It's amazing, right here in Manhattan. Environmental justice and climate justice are not issues that are necessarily right in your face, according to Kendall Crawford, who's the director of the Virginia Interfaith Power and Light. He says, but like police brutality or bias, we may face it in the corporate world, but in many cases, it's just as deadly. What else is happening? Something else that we can do. Well, I've been talking about extinction. How many of you have heard about the Extinction Rebellion? Ah, you have one. Oh, a few more. Okay. I hope that all of you will learn more about the Extinction Rebellion and will participate. It started in the UK. In London, they closed down the metro. They closed down some of the bridges there. They took to the streets and they shut down a lot of the city to call attention to what's happening. I think you probably have listened to the video from Greta Thunberg. She spoke at Davos. She and many other young people are part of this movement taking to the streets. In some of the big cities in Copenhagen, in Stockholm, in Berlin, young people are walking out of school and taking to the streets, calling attention to the way that the adults in their lives are squandering their futures. They don't have a future if we don't do something. The explosive growth of the Extinction Rebellion, which began in England with support of a group of academics just a few months ago, already has 190 affiliates on 5 continents, and it's fueled the ballooning ranks of people around the world who are frustrated, alarmed, and depressed by the failure of their governments to take real action. It's drawn inspiration from the civil rights movement, from Occupy Wall Street, from HIV/AIDS protest groups, ACT UP. Extinction Rebellion makes clear demands, among them that the government must tell the truth about the climate and enact legally binding policy measures to reduce carbon emissions to net zero by 2025. It also aims to acknowledge and draw on the intense emotions that come with the environmental calamity that's upon us. As one of the organizers, founders in England put it, even while resolving to limit the damage, we can mourn. We can mourn what we're going through. And so I leave you with that because there is hope. Why? Because we can imagine it. And that's one thing we really can do, and that's one thing that Homo sapiens do really well, right? We can imagine it. And we can humbly listen to the stories of people who are suffering now with the impact of global climate change and not be so damned privileged about it. There was an article in today's paper about the wealthy people who go to ski, right? And they love it. If there's not enough snow, they're willing to pay to make those snow machines make some more snow on the slopes. Aspen, other places, you've heard of them. They're wealthy enough to put their money both into the research and into the changing what's going on in their countries and others. What's lacking? Political will. Do they not have children, grandchildren? Hubris alone, in terms of having your own personal legacy of your DNA continuing, that alone, I would think, would move some people to action. Well, again, I think Extinction Rebellion has a good thing going, and next time, and you can check, just Google it, and you'll see the next time they're having an action. Some of them were at the ice skating rink at Rockefeller Center, and they lay down on the ice, and they formed the logo of their organization right there on the ice. So They drew attention to themselves. There are many other ways of drawing attention to this problem, and I leave it to you to find more and to join our Environmental Stewardship Committee. And I close with a poem by Anne Alexander Bingham. It's called, It Is Enough. It is enough to know that the atoms of my body will remain, to think of them rising through the roots of a great oak, to live in leaves, branches, twigs, perhaps to feed the crimson peony, the blue iris, the broccoli, or rest on water, freeze and thaw with the seasons. Some atoms might become a bit of fluff on the wing of a chickadee, to feel the breeze, know the support of air. And some might drift up and up into space, stardust, returning from whence it came. It is enough to know that as long as there is a universe, I am a part of it. Thank you.